Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Lacan, A Beginner's Guide, written by Lionel Bailly and read by Deidre Rubenstein. Acknowledgement. When I asked Sham Ambiyavagar to edit this book, it was still in the form of an early draft, and much of what I had intended for it was drawn from my years of lecturing on the subject, from my own analysis, and from my clinical practice. Sham's questions highlighted occasional weaknesses in the Lacanian edifice, or in my understanding of it. However, as a non-clinician, her research was book-based, and her understandings derived by a mixture of insight and logic rather than clinical experience. Her argumentative approach forced me to account for what my years of Lacanian practice revealed of the theory, and it seems to me that many of Lacan's greatest insights were intuitive and clinically derived, and not logical philosophical constructs. Sham's insistence upon attempting a unified theory, whether or not one may indeed be arrived at, has also contributed to the readability of the final product, although I would not wish to pretend that there are no holes in it, which hopefully will continue to attract constructive contributions. In addition, my mother tongue is French, and I speak English, while hers is English and she can speak French. We had to negotiate over the meaning of words and the impossibility or unhelpfulness of direct translation. This led us sometimes to unusual ways of translating concepts or fragments of texts, which I think are useful, as they preserve the French meaning better than exact translations, which do not work in the spirit of English. Overall, the process of working with Sham was unexpectedly rich and complex, and without it, this book would not exist. Introduction. Jacques Lacan was first of all a psychiatrist, and as a clinician, he was more concerned with what he did not know or understand than what he did. His inability to make do with a poor explanation led him to consider and explore all models available to psychiatrists in the first part of the 20th century. After having worked with some of the most brilliant proponents of organic psychiatry, he found in psychoanalysis the most helpful theoretical model to understand and treat the complex patients he was dealing with. However, Lacan was to become more than just a disciple of Freud. He believed that Freudian theory was not a perfect edifice, but a work in progress, and wanted to contribute towards what he saw as a developing model. His attitude towards the development of theory was modern, in that he was willing to examine any body of science that could clarify or shed new light on the phenomena he was trying to explain. And consequently, he drew inspiration from biological psychiatry, genetic psychology, and philosophy. Later, structural linguistics, anthropology, and even mathematics joined the range of theoretical models he used. The result was extraordinary, and its richness has attracted students in fields far from psychoanalysis or psychiatry. Indeed, although Lacan's model is not a philosophical one, it has become most fashionable among students of philosophy. One could go so far as to say that in the English-speaking world, it is largely philosophers and academics in English and critical studies departments who have kept Lacanian thought alive. Certainly, in the field from which Lacan himself came, that of psychiatry, his work is mostly ignored. This may be because philosophers and academics in the humanities are, in one respect, better equipped to deal with his writings than students of psychiatry or psychology, They are better prepared to try to understand a thinker whose productions are sometimes irritatingly obscure. There are three reasons behind the obscurity, which arise mostly from the manner in which Lacanian theory was formulated. Most Lacanian theory has been gathered from Lacan's spoken teachings. His technique was that of the philosophers of the classical world who expounded and developed their ideas in a discourse with their pupils. He wrote very little for publication. In even the most lucid speaker, transcriptions from speech are often problematic. The speech of a man who engaged his audience by many means other than pure logical exposition becomes quite obscure when written down. In order to make his points, Lacan often relied on dramatic devices, the well-timed pause, the leaving of a half-finished thought hanging in the air, the impact of his own personality, and perhaps most of all, on the ability of his audience to arrive of their own accord at the desired conclusion, by making the final mental connections themselves, as one should in analysis. And this mode of expression makes frustrating reading. The only writings Lacan can be held responsible for are his écrits, which were, it seems, rather painfully extracted from him by a publisher in 1966. In these, he maintains his abstruse, suggestive style, leading the reader towards an idea, but never becoming absolutely explicit, unless by means of a mathem. More on this shortly. I would also suggest that Lacan's impenetrable style was due, surprisingly, to a kind of intellectual caution, which made him wary of making sloppy and indefensible pronouncements, and that his fear of being misconstrued, coupled with a natural ineptness in communication, led to him literally tying his meanings up in verbal knots, hedging about every half-statement with half a dozen qualifying sub-clauses, and obsessively weighing each and every word. Secondly, the controversy that surrounded his working life and the strong passions he engendered in his followers and detractors have made it quite difficult to discover what he actually said. Lacan became mythologized even when he was alive. His seminars, the main arena in which he expounded his ideas, were inherited by Jacques Alain Miller, his son-in-law and disciple, who has kept tight control over their release. Some of his most important ideas have never been published, but are only referred to in other works. Also, he thought on his feet. The ideas expounded in his seminars were never intended to be cast in stone, and there are contradictions and discrepancies in his recorded utterances. Recorded, it must be noted, by faithful followers subject to their own preconceptions and interpretations. Thirdly, Lacan was an inventor of concepts, and freely ascribes to common words new meanings within his theoretical model, just as would a philosopher, or for that matter, any inventor. Accordingly, in order to understand his theory, listeners must learn to accept new definitions for words and drop the assumptions they may already have. Acquiring the Lacanian vocabulary is a prerequisite for being able to understand his theoretical models, particularly as they became more and more complex, building upon concepts he invented and named. This is an intellectual approach that students of philosophy are perhaps more used to than medical students, and which may explain why Lacanian ideas are more often discussed in humanities departments of universities than in a clinical context. This is a pity, because Lacan's work, like Freud's, is not philosophy, but a metapsychology, a theoretical framework within which to understand the individual. It is best understood in the context of a therapeutic relationship between an analysand and an analyst. In other words, a patient and a therapist. This is why students of pure philosophy may have problems with central Lacanian concepts. They have not witnessed in a patient what he is talking about. It is also why clinical practitioners may be able to grasp and apply his concepts intuitively, while being quite unable to explain them in logical terms. Lacan, despite the fuzziness of his communication style, strove desperately hard for intellectual rigor. It was perhaps this that made his relationship with words so fraught. And it was certainly this that drove him increasingly towards mathematical formulae to express without ambiguity what he meant. But at the end of the day, it is not pure logic, but clinical relevance that validates Lacan's model. And this book attempts to bridge the gap between the two. Author's note. As this book is intended for listeners without a background in psychoanalysis or psychology, I have introduced concepts early on by way of some deliberate oversimplifications, and then built upon the understanding so conveyed with the addition of layers of complexity. I hope that at the end, what is gained by the listener will be a relatively faithful understanding of his ideas. For the sake of clarity, I have capitalized certain words which Lacan never did. Real. Imaginary, symbolic, subject, phallus. This is to avoid any even fleeting ambiguity, as these words also have other commonplace meanings that may intrude as a distraction. By capitalizing these words, I wish to designate these particular Lacanian meanings so that I may use the words with their other meanings, uncapitalized, without risk of confusion. The narration will highlight these capitalized words by delivering them with a strong emphasis. Chapter 1. Lacan in his historical context. If the 1890s saw the birth of psychoanalysis, then the 1920s saw it reach a kind of adolescence, where across Europe it was breaking free of its parental boundaries and seeking its place in the wider intellectual world. As an attractive and intriguing newcomer, it was courted by many different older disciplines, medicine, art, literature, whose practitioners took it up with enthusiasm, used and abused it, gossiped about and fought over it. Equally, it worried others in those and other fields who felt it to be an upstart threat. Psychoanalysis itself, with the promiscuous spirit of exploration and creativity of youth, absorbed far-reaching and sometimes unexpected influences from the surrealists, from linguists, from poets. In Paris, the 1920s also saw the intellectual blossoming of a generation of young psychiatrists whose relationship with the new science, to use the word in its broad sense, was to lay the foundations of French psychoanalysis as it is today. Psychoanalysis in France had different roots from its Viennese parent. Viennese psychoanalysis grew up with middle-class neurotics on the couch. French psychoanalysis grew up with psychotic patients in the bleak wards of mental asylums. It was also something of a late developer, with a medical establishment there not really taking the new ideas into their bosom until the 1920s. Then, at St. Anne's Hospital in Paris, the French capital's main mental hospital, two departmental heads, Gaëtan de Clérambault at the L'Infirmerie Psychiatrique de la Préfecture de Police, and Henri Claude, began to have a far-reaching impact on the development of psychoanalysis in their country. The contribution of the former was accidental. Clérambault himself never took to the new idea, But Henri Claude was enthusiastic about it, and in his unit at St. Anne Hospital, an analysand of Freud's, Eugenie Sokolnikar, was allowed to analyze the younger psychiatrists. With Claude's encouragement, many of these people, or their own analysands, were to become the founder members of the French psychoanalytic movement. René Laforgue, Edouard Pichon, René Allendy, and Sophie Morgenstern among them. In 1926, under the firmly steering hand of Princess Marie Bonaparte, they founded the Société Psychanalytique de Paris, SPP, which became the most important psychoanalytical organization in France and remains one of the two French groups officially affiliated to the International Psychoanalytic Association, IPA. Claire Rambaud was a controversial figure because of his eccentric and difficult personality and had no time for psychoanalysis, but he was an extraordinary clinician whose detailed descriptions of psychotic symptoms still form a benchmark of clinical excellence. In his first psychiatric work, L'Automatisme Mental, written in 1909, Claire Rambaud suggested that the mechanism of mental automatism, when the mind appears to work independently of conscious control, might be responsible for experiences of hallucination. He divided mental automatism into three types: associative, sensory, and motor. Associative automatism includes disturbances in the form of thought, such as hallucinatory thoughts that occur as if you have no control over them. Sensory automatism manifests itself as unpleasant feelings in internal organs thought to be caused by somebody else. And motor automatism involves the delusional belief that somebody else performs one's movement and actions. Claire Rambaud also left his name to a form of paranoid disorder, the delusion of being loved, now known among English speakers as Claire Rambaud's syndrome, erotomanic delusion, or erotomania. He described this condition in 1920.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.